It is a glorious Sunday morning when we celebrate the Lord's resurrection. We have a living Savior. Well, we have a great text of Scripture also to celebrate that. It's Luke chapter 24, and we're going to look at verses 13 through 35. I'll read the entire text. And behold, two of them were going that very day to a village named Emmaus, which was about 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they were talking with each other about all these things which had taken place. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself approached and began traveling with them. But their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are these words that you are exchanging with one another as you are walking?" And they stood still, looking sad. One of them, named Cleopas, answered and said to him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem and unaware of the things which have happened here in these days?" And he said to them, "What things?" And they said to him, "The things about Jesus the Nazarene, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word, in the sight of God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to the sentence of death and crucified him. But we were hoping that it was he who was going to redeem Israel. Indeed, besides all this, it is the third day since these things happened. But also some women among us amazed us when they were at the tomb early in the morning. Did not find his body, they came saying that they had also seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just exactly as the women also had said, but him they did not see. And he said to them, "O foolish men and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary for the Christ to suffer these things and to enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them the things concerning himself in all the scriptures. And they approached the village where they were going, and he acted as though he were going farther. But they urged him, saying, "Stay with us, for it is getting toward evening, and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. When he had reclined at the table with them, he took the bread and blessed it, and breaking it, he began giving it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to one another, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was speaking to us on the road, while he was explaining the scriptures to us?" And they got up that very hour and returned to Jerusalem and found gathered together the 11 and those who were with them, saying, "The Lord has really risen and has appeared to Simon." They began to relate their experience on the road and how he was recognized by them in the breaking of the bread. May the Lord bless this reading of his word and bless our time of studying it together. Let's bow in a word of prayer. After the death of the French scientist and philosopher Blaise Pascal, an interesting discovery was made. Stitched in the lining of his coat, a paper was found dated 7 years earlier, and on it were pinned, "Fire. God of Abraham, God of Isaac, God of Jacob, not of philosophers and scholars. Certainty, certainty, feeling, joy, peace." Peace and joy and fire. Who hasn't longed for that? Who hasn't felt that at times their Christian life lacked them, lacked energy and the devotion to God that we should have? And you wonder, how can I get that fire? We get it the same way that two discouraged disciples got it when they were walking home one day with the Son of God. At the end of their visit, they looked in amazement at one another and said, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was speaking to us?" That's the lesson of Luke 24, verses 13 through 35. It's a story of fellowship with the resurrected Christ and the change that brings, the joy and the peace that he gives. That's what these two lacked when the story begins. They were two dejected, dispirited disciples. They had been in Jerusalem for the Passover. They had been caught up in the excitement of the moment, expecting Jesus to proclaim himself king and establish the throne of David, when things suddenly changed. He was arrested, tried, and crucified. Before the sun set Friday evening, his lifeless body had been taken from the cross and laid in a tomb. Then it was over. Their hopes for the future shattered. They spent the Sabbath in Jerusalem, and then the next day on Sunday prepared to return home when they heard reports that the Lord's tomb was empty, and in fact that the Lord was alive. They didn't know what to make of that. They knew clearly he had died. He had suffered crucifixion. He'd been wrapped in burial cloths and spices. He'd been laid in a tomb. How could he be alive? The news only added to their confusion. And so in late afternoon, they left Jerusalem and they made their way home to Emmaus, some 7 miles west of the city. As they walked, they talked about the events that had taken place, trying to make sense of them as the sun was setting. The scene of them walking into the sunset, I think, captures the mood of the moment. They had expected a glorious dawn of a kingdom. Instead, shadows were closing around them as they walked toward the night. Jesus had been crucified, and their hope had died with him. And so they walked on in deep sadness. That was when the Lord came to them. He approached them, we read, and began traveling with them. But we still don't know who they were. They were obviously disciples of our Lord. They lived in the town of Emmaus, but there doesn't seem to be anything outstanding about them, no reason for singling them out. In fact, Luke only mentions the name of one of them, Cleopas. The identity of the other is unknown to us, but not to the Lord. And he took the greatest interest in both of them. That's part of the charm of this story. One of his few recorded resurrection appearances is to these simple, unknown disciples. And there's a reminder of something in that, and that is everyone is equally significant to Jesus. Not one more than others, all equally, infinitely important to him. And so he overtook them on the way. I like that scene because it's a reminder of who he is. It's a reminder that he is a pursuing God. He doesn't leave us to ourselves. He doesn't leave us in our sorrow. He comes to us. He said that he came into this world to seek and to save that which is lost. And he has done that. And he finds us. And when he finds us, he changes us. But having changed us, he doesn't leave us to ourselves. He comes to us in times of discouragement, and he travels with us. And so we read that he began traveling with them. Now, you'd think that his appearance would have thrilled them, but they didn't recognize him. To him, he was just another pilgrim returning home from Jerusalem and the great feast. They didn't see that it was Jesus because, Luke writes, their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. Now, Luke doesn't tell us what it was that prevented them. If it was their ignorance of the truth or their unbelief. Ignorance and unbelief blind the eyes, and it blinds the eyes of the believer as well. Christians can have lack of understanding and unbelief as well. That's why Paul prayed in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 18, for the Ephesians, that God would open the eyes of their heart, that he would enlighten the eyes of their heart. We all need the eyes of our heart enlightened, our minds open to the truth. We never come to that point where we understand it all. And to the degree that we don't, we lack a great deal. And they did. So the Lord can be with his people and they may not see him because of something in themselves. Still, he walked on with them. And again, that's instructive. Jesus can be near us and be unrecognized. He's always present, but we may not be conscious of him. We may be far from him in our thoughts and affections, so unsettled by circumstances that we think of them and we don't think of him, but he's never far from us. He is alive and always faithful. He never abandons us. He promised that. I am with you always, even to the end of the age. And so the pursuing God is also the persevering God, persevering and patient with us in our weakness. And then in his time and in his way, he reveals himself to us. So he traveled along with them a while. Then finally, in verse 17, interrupted their conversation with a question. What are these words that you are exchanging with one another as you're walking? Well, that got their attention. They stopped in the road, shocked that anyone coming from Jerusalem would be uninformed about the most momentous weekend of history. And standing there looking sad, Luke writes, Cleopas asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem and unaware of the things which have happened in these days?" In other words, where have you been, man? Then, as if to draw them in even more, the Lord asked, "What things?" And they answered by unburdening their hearts to him. They recounted the Lord's ministry as a prophet, mighty in deed and word in the sight of God and all the people, and how their leaders delivered him up to the sentence of death and crucified him. Then they added a very sad note in verse 21. But we were hoping that it was he who was going to redeem Israel. In other words, they knew he was a man of God. He was a prophet. In fact, they thought that he was more than that, that he was their redeemer, which is a significant description of our Lord, more so even than they themselves knew. The word redeem means to deliver by means of the payment of a price. And it was a word that was used in that time of paying money to free a slave. It's used of Jesus. It's used of our Lord delivering us from sin and judgment at the cost of his own life, at the shedding of his blood. But these two individuals likely had something else in mind, something less enlightened, something less spiritual. They had hoped that he would deliver Israel from its material political oppression, like God did in the Exodus when he freed the nation from slavery and brought them out and brought them into the land. And they had hoped that this one now would make Israel great again. They hoped for redemption by force of arms. But that hope ended with his crucifixion, and they concluded that he was only a prophet, a good man who, like so many before him, had suffered death at the hands of their leaders. The irony is, of course, that by suffering that death, by dying, he had done the very thing that they hoped for. And in fact, he had gained for them a freedom far greater than the one that they had anticipated. Freedom from hopelessness and despair, freedom from sin and judgment, freedom from the fear of death. He'd gained for them eternal life. But not understanding that, they were completely dejected. Still, they had heard a report that morning that amazed them. Some women had gone to the tomb early in the morning and found it empty. They reported that they saw angels who said that he was alive. And some of the men had found the tomb just as the women had said, but they had him they did not see. In other words, the body was gone. There are witnesses to that. There's historical testimony to that fact that the tomb was empty, but they didn't see him, and an empty tomb didn't prove a resurrection. That was just too incredible to believe. So they didn't, and they left for home sad and confused. And what that demonstrates is faith is the beginning of knowledge. Augustine said, "Believe so that you may understand." And there was ample revelation, much revelation to believe. The prophets had revealed Christ's death and resurrection, but these two didn't heed the prophets. They didn't believe. And so they didn't understand the cross. They didn't understand the empty tomb. The blessing of all of that was a tragedy to them. Well, if they expected their new traveling companion to sympathize with them, they were mistaken. And his response must have startled them. "Oh, foolish men and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary for the Christ to suffer these things and to enter into his glory?" The death of Christ was no accident of history. It was necessary. Necessary to fulfill prophecy, true, but necessary to give life. Necessary to gain hope, forgiveness, resurrection for all who believe. Necessary for all of that. So to correct that, Jesus took them through a systematic Bible study, which is always the solution to ignorance, to unbelief, and the solution, the remedy for sadness. Luke writes in verse 27 that beginning with Moses and with all the prophets, he explained to them the things concerning himself. What a sermon that must have been. We don't have it, but we do have his text, all the scriptures, from beginning to end, because the whole Old Testament is filled with Christ. He's the key to the Bible. He must have begun, I'm speculating, but I feel certain he must have begun with Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. It speaks of Jesus as the seed, as Eve's descendant, one who would become a man, who would represent humanity, and who would, in his death, crush the head of the serpent, Satan, reference to the cross. The Lord may have moved on to Exodus chapter 12 and verse 13 and the meaning of the Passover lamb's blood that was placed on the Hebrews' houses, the doors of their houses in Egypt, and how the shedding of blood brought redemption from judgment. Then through Leviticus with the altar and animals of sacrifice, all of which prefigured him. The offering of the Day of Atonement, whose blood was sprinkled on the mercy seat of the ark, and the scapegoat on whose head the priest would put his hands and confess the sins of the nation, and then it would be driven out into the wilderness, a way of signifying the removal of sin and guilt through sacrifice. Perhaps he spoke of the evening and morning sacrifices, the daily reminder that without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. He no doubt went through the Psalms, such as Psalm 1 and Psalm 22 and Psalm 69, and many others which foretold his suffering and death. And then certainly he went to the suffering servant of Isaiah 52 and 53, where his sacrificial death is described in the words, "He was pierced through for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. the chastening of our well-being, that is, the chastening, the suffering that is necessary for our well-being, fell upon him. And by his scourging, we are healed. There's sin and there's healing in that passage. And it's through him. Well, those words were not written of any mere man, obviously, but Christ Jesus, because only he, as the sinless servant, could be our substitute and suffer in such a way as to pay the debt of our sin. From there, he might have gone on to the prophet Zechariah and the striking of God's shepherd in chapter 13, verse 7. Well, of course, we don't know which scriptures he touched on. There are so many of them, and he only had a little bit of time allotted to him, at least a small amount of time compared to all of the scripture that he could have unfolded for them. But he was able to give a broad outline from the Old Testament of the teaching that was concerned with him, the teaching about him. And what he chose was designed to show one main lesson, and that is that it was necessary for the Christ to suffer. That is the essential feature of Christ's teaching and work. Take the cross away, and everything falls apart. Without the cross, Christianity is just another religion of morality, a system of ethics and effort without life or hope. There's no release from sin apart from Christ's death. Oh, that's the testimony of the apostles. That's the testimony of John, who says in Revelation chapter 1, verse 5, "To him who loves us and released us from our sins in his blood." I love that statement, him who loves us presently. That's written in light of the resurrection. He is alive. He presently loves us and has released us from our sins by his blood, by his sacrificial death as our substitute. That was necessary. But that necessity is what men hate. The message of man's sin, of man's guilt, of his unworthiness, of his helplessness is what causes everything in the natural man to rise up in revolt. The Countess of Huntingdon was a great patroness of evangelical preaching during the Great Awakening in England, and would invite her peers to her home to hear the great preachers. George Whitefield was frequently the preacher. On one occasion, he spoke to the lords and ladies. He told them, "It is a true and living faith in the Son of God that can alone bring present peace. Only release from sin and guilt and the oppression of it is through faith in the Son of God." And he urged them to believe. "He is reaching out to you," he said. "May you continue, or may you be constrained to give your heart entirely to him." Some were unimpressed. The Duchess of Buckingham was more than unimpressed. She was greatly annoyed. She later wrote a letter to the Countess expressing her displeasure. "It is monstrous to be told that you have a heart as sinful as the common wretches that crawl on the earth. This is highly offensive and insulting." Nothing new there. That's why Paul spoke of the offense of the cross. It is the monument to our guilt. It is the proof that we are all sinners and that the stain of sin is so deep we cannot remove it with our best efforts. Jesus said it was necessary for the Christ to suffer because it's the only remedy for sin. Apart from the cross, we can't understand our condition, how grave it is. Apart from the cross, we cannot understand Christ. Luther described Christian theology as theology of the cross. It's through the scandal of the cross that God revealed himself to us. revealed His love for us and His saving purpose for us. And His purpose and promise to save the lost runs throughout the Bible, throughout the Old Testament, as the Lord demonstrated on that walk to Emmaus, and it's all through the New Testament. But the Old Testament prophets spoke not only of our Lord's suffering, but also of His resurrection, His passing into glory. In Psalm 16, verse 10, David wrote, "For thou wilt not abandon my soul to Sheol, neither wilt thou allow thy Holy One to undergo decay." And Peter cites that psalm in Acts chapter 2 during his sermon on the day of Pentecost to prove the resurrection. And he pointed out that David wasn't writing of himself. His body had been laid in the tomb. His body had turned to dust. And Peter pointed to David's tomb. It was still there in Jerusalem. They could visit that tomb. David was prophesying of another. He was prophesying of Jesus, the Messiah. The tomb where he was laid was empty. It was all prophesied long before by the prophets and by Jesus himself. In John chapter 10, verse 17, he said, "I lay down my life so that I may take it again." The two belong together. The resurrection is the proof that the Father accepted the Son's sacrifice for our sins. Christ's "it is finished" is the declaration of victory. The resurrection is the proof of that victory. And so it's likely that that's where the Lord concluded His sermon to these two disciples, with the resurrection and perhaps with Psalm 16. Wherever it ended all too soon for these two disciples. But finally, they came to the end of their journey. It was becoming dark as they approached the village. And Luke writes in verse 28 that the Lord was acting as though He would go farther and would have gone farther had they not urged Him to stay. So at their request, He went in to stay with them, where we read He reclined at the table to share a meal with them. That was when everything became clear. When He had reclined at table with them, He took the bread and blessed it, and breaking it, He began giving it to them. Suddenly, we read, their eyes were opened and they recognized Him. What it was that caused this to occur, we're not told. Maybe at that moment, as He began to break the bread, they saw the nail prints in His hands. Or maybe they recalled how they had seen in the past Him taking bread and breaking it, as He had done many times. Whatever it was, certainly at that moment, the Lord opened the eyes of their heart, as it were, revealed Himself to them, and they realized that this was no stranger. This was the Savior. Then He vanished from their sight. Why did He do that? Well, perhaps because they had to learn that He would no longer be present with them physically, as He had been from His incarnation to His crucifixion and resurrection. They needed to be instructed and reminded that the resurrected Lord would be present with them through the Holy Spirit, and we would apprehend Him and walk with Him by faith. And as they sat there together, they said to one another, "Were not our hearts burning within us while He was speaking to us on the road, while He was explaining the Scriptures to us?" Their hearts were burning. The grammar is significant. Were burning. It was a constant experience that they had as they walked along with Him. I think it was an experience that kept building within them. They experienced warmth. They continued to experience joy and peace. These discouraged disciples were no longer discouraged. They were lifted out of that by our Lord and by His instruction. And that's the key thing to notice there. He was with them teaching Scripture. Notice their hearts were burning while He was explaining the Scriptures to them, literally opening the Scriptures to us. passages that previously had puzzled them or had been neglected by them were made clear to them. They heard things that they'd never thought of. I'd never seen that before. I've read that passage many times and never saw that. And suddenly they understood. And the result was their hearts burned within them. That's the key. It's as we walk with Christ, fellowship with Him through the study of Scripture, that we have burning hearts, that we experience the reality of the Christian life and the joy of it. It's as we fellowship with Him at the Lord's table on a Sunday night, or as we'll do in a few moments. It's the Lord's table. It's not our table, it's the Lord's table, and He invites us to come there to pray and reflect upon what He has done for us. It's as we come in contact with Christ, our living head, our resurrected Savior, that we have joy, that our hearts are melted and set ablaze. Howell Harris was a Welshman and a great evangelist. He was described as a man reticent of temperament, a man who was reserved, not a person given to standing before people and speaking boldly, publicly. But while he was taking the Lord's Supper, he thought about Christ on the cross and trusted in Him. That was when the chains fell off and his heart was free. Then he said, "I was convinced that Christ died for me and that all my sins were laid on Him. I was now acquitted before the bar of justice." Later, as he prayed, he described his heart as being filled with the fire of the love of God. Now, that's real fire. The genuine joy that the knowledge of the love of God gives us as we reflect upon that and what He has done for us, at what cost that He has done it for us. And Mr. Harris became a great evangelist. John Wesley had a similar experience in a house on Aldersgate Street in London. He was a graduate of Oxford, a minister of the Church of England, a very religious man, but he didn't know Christ. As he sat listening to a man read from Luther's preface to Paul's Epistle to the Romans, he heard the gospel and immortalized the moment in the words, "I felt my heart strangely warmed." With one, it was the Lord's Supper, and the other, it was the teaching of God's Word, but the hearts of both of them were set aflame with the love of God, and they responded by going and telling others. That was the response of these two Emmaus disciples. They were transformed by Christ and His words, and so filled with joy that they got up immediately and returned to Jerusalem. Now remember, they just walked 7 miles. They were tired. It was now dark and dangerous, but they had good news. They had the best news. It couldn't wait. Jesus was alive. Christ is risen. They'd seen Him. They had walked with Him. He spoke to them. He opened the Scriptures to them. He gave them knowledge of Him and made their hearts burn within them. So, do you lack that fire? Then perhaps you're not walking with Christ. Perhaps you're not studying Scripture and observing the Lord's Supper. These are the places we meet the living God. And as we meet Him in His Word, He teaches us through the Holy Spirit. We know Him. We know His truth and grace. We are assured of His help at all times as the Savior who is alive and never leaves us. That's what warms the heart and kindles in us what Charles Wesley called an inextinguishable blaze. The truth of God's Word. The good news of Easter, of every Sunday, and really for the Christian, of every day, is the resurrection. Jesus Christ is alive. We have a living Savior. God has accepted His Son's sacrifice for us. The work of salvation is finished. He now invites the guilty. He invites the weary to come to Him, to receive salvation, to receive eternal life. He invites those who know that they are sinners and in need of a Savior to come. And all who do come to Him, who believe in Him, are accepted by Him and in fact become a home for the living God. He lives within us. He walks with us and leads us into truth and righteousness. Is He with you? Have you received the salvation that He offers? It's free. He paid for the sins of sinners so that all who believe in Him, who simply trust in Him, find rest for their souls through the Redeemer. So if not, trust in Christ. And you who have, rejoice. We have a living Savior who is with us always and who alone can set our heart on fire, and will do it as we look to Him. Let's pray. Father, we do thank You for the great truth of this text. It's not just a nice story. It's an historical account. It's what happened to these two individuals and happened to others. It happens to people down through the ages as they come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, recognize that they're sinners in need of a Savior and turn to Him, and He receives them. You receive us. Receive us into Your family and make us children of God, sons and daughters of God. We thank You for that, Father. And pray that You'd fill our hearts with joy as we consider that we have received eternal life. This temporal life is just that. It is temporal. It is like a sigh, the psalmist said. We're like a vapor, James says. We are here for but a moment, but we have all eternity before us. And the trials and the difficulties of this life will evaporate in light of the eternal joy and glory that You will give us. We thank You for what Your Son has done for us, and it's in His name we pray. Amen.